Now, this is the part of the story that gets a little strange. So stick with me if you can. I had asked the Old Capitol Inn staff about music recommendations, in part because it felt like I should. And it turns out the music venue recommendation they gave me was one I ended up checking out. And what happened there stayed with me. It's one reason why I'm making this video. Eventually, I arrived in Jackson at the Old Capitol Inn where I would be staying that night. The place exudes hospitality, and it charmed me right from the start. This is Ricky, one of the inn staff members who was working the reception desk when I arrived. After I told her that I might be shooting a video of my road trip, she mentioned that Chadwick Boseman had been in the area while shooting Get On Up, the James Brown biopic. Behind me on the wall was a framed photograph with him and one of the other hotel representatives, which confirmed her story. As it happens, the director of Get On Up, Tate Taylor, was born in Jackson, and the film he made prior to Get On Up was The Help, which was set in Jackson. I realized as much after the road trip, when I went back and revisited Get On Up. The film had recurring significance on the trip, so I was curious to see if watching it again would help me organize this video. It did, a little bit. After I dropped off my bags, I walked around the city to get a better sense of the area. This is the War Memorial Building. Built in 1939 to 1940, it has since been listed on the National Register of Historic Places. To give some context about why it resonated, I should mention that my dad was a naval doctor. For much of his career in the Navy, he was stationed to support Naval Station Norfolk, the world's biggest naval base. The first battle between ironclads, early predecessors to contemporary battleships, happened in Norfolk. Norfolk is also the home of General Douglas MacArthur's memorial and tomb, and his influence is felt even today. The MacArthur Mall, which opened in 1999 in the heart of downtown Norfolk, is named after him. My childhood home is also within driving distance of Yorktown, the battlefield that ended the Revolutionary War. Actually, I went back to Yorktown while making this video and I picked up this. And this. What can I say? I like souvenirs, all right? All that to say, I grew up around the military community, and that helped instill in me an appreciation for those who serve. Here's another bit of trivia I heard from someone in the military. During the Cold War, Norfolk was supposedly number 3 on the list of places to nuke, the first being Washington, D.C., the country's political capital. Number 2 would be New York, the financial center. And then supposedly Norfolk was number 3 because it had the capacity to build a retaliatory fleet. I haven't seen that confirmed anywhere in writing, but it makes sense. Whatever the case may be, I didn't grow up doing duck and cover drills in school. That was a different era.
He did what we all must learn to do.
You
and you
and you
and you.
Duck and cover.
You know how bad sunburn can feel. The atomic bomb flash could burn you worse than a terrible sunburn.
Societies are always trying to protect themselves from something. It's just the particulars that change over time. After walking around Jackson for a bit, I circled back to the Old Capitol Inn. While its rooftop bar and courtyard area were appealing bonuses, I picked it because it's literally right across the street from museums I wanted to check out: the Museum of Mississippi History and the Mississippi Civil Rights Museum, both of which opened in 2017 to coincide with the state's bicentennial. Walking to the museums, I discovered this mural on the back of the Old Capitol Inn. Hey, look, there's Our Lady Eudora Welty. Hey! Anyway, as I suggested earlier, a big part of the road trip is wanting to go and better appreciate the country, one state at a time, in this case, Mississippi. So I wanted to set aside plenty of time to explore both museums. They're right next to each other, and one ticket will get you admittance into both. One recurring stylistic element of both museums is the way the video rooms are oriented around a theme. Here by the entrance, the monitors are meant to evoke smoke by a campfire, as Morgan Freeman's voice tells us a little bit about the state history. Other media rooms evoke a church, a segregation-era classroom, a broadcast control room, and so on. It's a noteworthy stylistic choice that makes the museum's substantive history more palatable. Helpful because Mississippi, like so many other places, is a compelling, albeit complicated, state. Come to think of it, that's probably true for so many places. It's just a matter of taking the time to notice. And I include Norfolk in that, a place that I had taken for granted growing up just because it was close to where I lived. I didn't think too much about it. Of personal interest to me regarding Mississippi, Muppets visionary Jim Henson was born and raised there. So is Archie Manning, star quarterback and father of Eli Manning, the quarterback who took my New York Giants to a couple of Super Bowl victories. So there's that. But then Jefferson Davis also grew up in Mississippi. He would go on to represent Mississippi in the House of Representatives and then the Senate, and then eventually became the president of the Confederacy during the Civil War. The Choctaw Indians also called Mississippi home at one point, but along with other tribes in surrounding areas, they were forcefully removed in what became known as the Trail of Tears. And while cotton brought riches to Mississippi in the 1800s, much of that wealth was created by slave labor. By 1860, slaves represented 55% of the state's population. Now, neither museum shied away from this uncomfortable reality, but the Mississippi Civil Rights Museum put particular emphasis on the cruelty that slavery and later segregation brought to the blacks in Mississippi. At the Mississippi Civil Rights Museum, I learned that Natchez, the city I would be visiting next, was at one point the most active slave market in Mississippi. Visiting the two museums was a powerful experience, and I'm glad I went, but in the back of my mind I was wondering, how am I going to incorporate this experience in a road trip video? Aren't road trip videos supposed to be more lighthearted and adventurous, possibly involving vivacious hipsters jumping off whatever waterfall happens to be in the area? You know, something like this. I paid a few pretty pennies for that stock clip, so let's watch it again. Now that you've gotten your fill of that, maybe you can stick with me a little bit as I try to search for meaning from the trip. I was kidding around before a little bit when I probably should be more serious, but how else am I supposed to reconcile my hopes and prayers for the trip with institutionalized cruelty and injustice? Speaking of prayer, if the hand of providence does intervene in human affairs, at least on occasion, it does bring up an uncomfortable question. Why in some instances and not in others? Put differently, if God allowed slavery, how likely is he to intervene in a favorable way in our lives? That's a substantial question, not one to gloss over, and I'll try to address it at least in some small way later. For now, let me acknowledge that's not a small question. Theologians have wrestled with it for years, even lifetimes. But then not being able to immediately reconcile all of the dissonance at hand isn't enough of a reason not to keep pressing forward with something. And this didn't start off as a theological inquiry. Or did it? I'm not sure. But in any case, let's move onward. Upstairs, the Museum of Mississippi History had an exhibit about the Prohibition era in Mississippi. Turns out that Mississippi was the first to ratify and the last to repeal Prohibition. I was more or less on schedule for the day, so I gave it a quick walkthrough, and the change in tone was a welcome nightcap to the museum experience. Technically, I guess it would be a day cap because, you know, during the day, but not quite the same because, well, as far as I know, you can't wear a day cap to bed. My next stop was the Eudora Welty House, which was constructed in the Tudor Revival style, named after the Tudor kings and queens who ruled England when it originated. That style makes me think of Shakespeare. Now, that might be because I'm a bit of a Shakespeare enthusiast, but then Elizabeth I, the last Tudor, was ruling when Shakespeare was born. So there is that connection. The Eudora Welty House, now a historical landmark and museum, was constructed by Eudora Welty's parents, and it's where she did all of her writing. So it doesn't seem like a stretch to suggest that growing up in a house that evokes the Shakespearean era may have had an influence on her decision to become a writer, whether or not she consciously acknowledges much. Speaking of influences, the museum did a nice job of accentuating her various interests. She enjoyed movies like The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari, that German expressionist classic, studied astronomy with her father's telescope, was a published photographer, spent time in the family garden, and even painted on occasion. It was a welcome reminder that artists draw on a variety of interests and experiences while creating their work. After leaving the Eudora Welty House, I drove to the State Capitol building. I missed the last tour of the day, so I drove around the building a couple of times to get a better sense of it. It was built between 1901 and 1903 in the Beaux Art style. Like other neoclassical buildings, it includes architectural elements like Doric, Ionic, and Corinthian columns that harken back to ancient Rome and Greece. Actually, every state capital I visited in the United States has neoclassical elements, an acknowledgement that our system of government is derived from the Roman Republic and Athenian democracy. For whatever reason, our culture's obsession with the dehumanizing tenets of modernism and postmodernism has not yet trickled into our government buildings, at least not the capitals. This may just be because cancel culture hasn't gotten around to destroying the functional and aesthetic buildings we already have. Who knows? I, for one, wouldn't want to live in a country that was run out of a building like this, but maybe that's just me. I'm an American whose parents were born in Greece, so maybe I'm a little biased, but I don't think that's the extent of it. Anyway, I spent more time circling the state's Capitol building than I care to admit. Part of that was wanting to get enough footage so that I could do a timed remap of it. But I think there may be more to it than that. Ever since I was a schoolboy, I've been intrigued by the American system of government. And by the time I was in high school, I had visited DC a couple of times and even gotten a tour of a couple of the prominent law firms in the area. That's one reason why a number of my teachers and family members thought that I would end up in law school. I did too for a while, but then I decided to go to film school instead, and the films of Frank Capra helped nudge me in that direction.
That's what's got to be in it.
What?
The Capitol Dome.
On paper?
I want to make that come to life for every boy in this land. Yes, and all light it up like that too. You see, boys forget what their country means by just reading the land of the free in history books. When they get to be men, they forget even more. Liberty is too precious a thing to be buried in books, Miss Saunders. Men should hold it up in front of them every single day of their lives and say, I'm free to think and to speak. My ancestors couldn't, I can. And my children will.
That still doesn't entirely explain why I was circling around the Capitol building again and again. Was I just trying to get the best possible footage, or was there more to it? Was I wondering in the back of my mind what my life might have been like had I gone to law school? Would I still have ended up circling around Capitol buildings searching for purpose for my life, or at least the project at hand? I don't know. But then, I don't always entirely understand why I do the things I do. Does anyone? Do you? As if to underscore how truly challenging it can be to understand why we do the things we do, Get On Up, the film I mentioned earlier about James Brown, begins with a seemingly bizarre moment in James Brown's life. And then much, if not most of the film, is spent trying to put that in context, trying to help us understand how he got to that point.
What would you do? I said, what would you do? Good God. Tell the devil gonna have to get that fixed. Now I'm a busy man. And I'm guessing you cats are too. But a person of convenience has been abused here. Which one of you gentlefolk hung a number two in my commode?
After leaving the state capitol building, I headed back to the old Capitol Inn, ready to check out their rooftop bar. Remember the Mississippi Distilled exhibit that I referenced a few minutes ago? They offered coasters with recipes for classic drinks that they gave to the guests, and one of them, the mint julep one, even had a quote from Eudora Welty. So I thought, surely everyone in town can fix it up in a moment's notice, and I was looking forward to trying one on the rooftop bar. If And only if it was a sufficiently pleasing mint julep. If it was a truly exceptional mint julep. I was thinking I might do something on video to show my appreciation for it. Something like saying, this here mint julep is a mighty fine mint julep. Mighty fine mint julep indeed, sir. Now, I'm not saying I would necessarily have treated the staff to my quasi Mississippi Riverboat Captain voice, but I might have had it been a sufficiently pleasing mint julep. I went up to the bar, asked them what kind of variation of the mint julep they can scrunch up. They looked at me and told me that they couldn't make a mint julep. Now, I'm not sure if this was because they ran out of ingredients or if that's just not a drink they make at the rooftop bar. So I ended up getting something else. It was their variation of the Tequila Sunrise or something. It was passable, but it was no mint julep, sir. Incidentally, this is the only photo I still have from the rooftop bar. Now, I'm not saying it was because I was annoyed that I couldn't get a mint julep, but I'm not saying it wasn't either. I do want to give the staff of the Old Capitol Inn credit for something, though. I was looking to hear live music that night and ask them for recommendations because we were still in the midst of the pandemic and a number of music venues had stopped doing live music in response. They gave me a few recommendations and then even called the venues to confirm. I was impressed and grateful for that. And while I didn't get many photos of their rooftop bar, I did take this video of their beautiful courtyard area while walking out and getting ready to explore other parts of Jackson that night. Now, this is the part of the story that gets a little strange. So stick with me if you can. I had asked the Old Capitol Inn staff about music recommendations, in part because it felt like I should, like it was somehow important to the trip that I go and hear live music that night, and more specifically, that I ask the staff for recommendations. And it turns out the music venue recommendation they gave me was one I ended up checking out. And what happened there stayed with me. It's one reason why I'm making this video. After I left the rooftop bar, I headed over to Pig and Pint, a well-regarded barbecue spot in the area. That's where I met Andrew while looking for a place to sit down. No, this isn't Andrew. This is the friendly bartender. Okay, quick editor's note here for you. The clip I tried to get of Andrew didn't record. All I got is this screenshot and shot of my food. Sorry about that. To make amends, here's a little video sequence I put together based on some stock footage I got from Envato Elements. You might be thinking I'm easily amused. You're probably right, but maybe it relates to the story at hand. You'll have to watch all the way through to the very end to find out if that's the case or if I just want an excuse to get some delicious barbecue here. So anyway, back to my conversation with Andrew after I eat a little bit of this. It turns out that Andrew was also in the midst of a road trip. He was telling me a little bit about some of his adventures. Then he mentioned that he had been working with his current employer since he was 23. That got my attention. The number 23 has recurring significance for me, and a few months before going on the road trip, I had posted a video about how I had gotten to meet Carlton Cuse, one of the showrunners of Lost, earlier that year. In that video, the number 23 came up far more often than usual, even in my life, rivaling its numerous appearances on the show. I'm grateful that I got to meet Carlton and make that video, but as sometimes happens when the number 23 is involved in my life, that situation was not without dissonance. So I wasn't exactly looking for the number. Actually, for some time after that video came out, I was actively trying to avoid that number. And then Andrew mentioned it without me prompting it from him in any way. Even so, he seemed like a friendly enough guy, so we were talking about what we were up to. I told him that the next day I was headed to Natchez to see their hot air balloon festival happening that weekend. To my surprise, he expressed interest in the event and even possibly coming along. That's something that seems so foreign to me. It wasn't even something I considered as a prospect, because in my world, it takes a while to get my friends to come and do something. I usually have to give them a few days, if not a few weeks, advance notice. And even then, things don't always pan out, as is evident with the road trip where I ended up going alone. Anyway, Andrew had expressed interest, so there was the possibility that he might come along and I could share the Balloon Festival experience with someone. I thought that would be great. I was excited about the possibility, but tried to play it cool. We exchanged contact information and said we would be in touch as our plans for the days to come unfolded. Now, if you're wondering why I didn't get footage of that, it's because I was excited about the possibility and I didn't want to ruin it prematurely by bringing out my camera phone and taking photos and videos, putting a lot of pressure on the moment. So that's why. After I left Pig and Pint, I headed over to Martin's downtown, the venue recommended to me by the Old Capitol Inn. The band playing was Strung Like a Horse, and locals in town told me they were worth checking out. The band describes themselves on their site as a high-energy, hard-hitting Americana band from Tennessee. So I was intrigued. I got a ticket and went inside. Shortly thereafter, I met Carly. After we chatted for a bit, I noticed that Carly had a tattoo on her arm that said 1, 2, 3. I asked her about it, and she said she got it in honor of her dad, who was born January 23rd, and that he had passed away recently. It's not just that. The conversation we had reminded me of, was reminiscent of, some of the things I talked about in the Lost video, specifically in regard to the death of my dad. Several years ago, my dad got a brain aneurysm unexpectedly, and then shortly thereafter, he passed away. And that was one of the most destabilizing times, if not the most destabilizing time in my life. It stung because it felt like we were improving our relationship, that it was almost right. And we were working on it, but it wasn't quite where I hoped it would be. And so that made it a little more difficult. That was the second time that night that I had run into the number 23 without seeking it out. Her tattoo said 1, 2, 3. There wasn't a space. I didn't see a space. I just asked her because I noticed it. I was looking for something to talk about. And was made to recall something I was trying not to think about that night. What's more, I wouldn't have even met Carly or had that conversation had I not asked the staff at the Old Capitol Inn for music recommendations that night. Martin's downtown wasn't even on my radar of places to check out. And yet, I did end up there. I did end up having that conversation. As if that wasn't bewildering enough, I realized later that wasn't the only instance of the number 23 that day. It turns out Eudora Welty died on July 23rd, 2001. even to this day, I'm not sure why the number 23 keeps showing up in my life in the sometimes unusual ways that it does. But I do know that had it not been for those three appearances that night, I probably wouldn't be making these videos. Because of what happened at the tail end of that road trip. Before I left Jackson, I met Rob while eating breakfast at the Old Capitol Inn. As if to cap the day's prior events, he told me that numbers of people were leaving California in droves, and that the ACLU was a factor in that. As it happens, that also relates to my lost video, but I didn't tell him that.